in this circumstance, a police officer does not have an in-person encounter with a person who's facing a search.
Okay?
Instead, the police officer either surreptitiously takes the photo from far away, or takes a photo from a surveillance camera, or some kind of other video footage, and then searches that photo against their database. Okay? Here, again, there is a state interest in figuring out, you know, who is that ATM robber, right? Who is this person committing this crime? And yet, in this instance, the search is entirely non-transparent to the public. In fact, it is, for all effective purposes, completely run in secret. And so we think that this is a much more sensitive search than the other kinds of searches, number one. And number two, that there is a very high potential for abuse. As we will discuss a little later, this technology has already been used to identify people standing in a protest in Maryland, in Baltimore. And so while this technology is promised for forensic purposes, it also could be misused to identify protesters. It could be misused to identify someone the police officer finds attractive. And this is not something I'm trying to impugn police departments. This is actually a problem in police databases. There's a powerful Associated Press study on audits of searches in police databases and how, in fact, sort of an officer looking up someone that the officer thinks is attractive, that actually happens quite a bit. What's the final and, in our view, most sensitive kind of search? It is a continuous face recognition search. You could call it a real-time search, but we don't limit it to real-time. We also think this applies to archival video. And this is the distinction. In stop and identify, in arrest and identify, in investigate and identify, I am searching one or a handful of faces in a particular circumstance, and I'm searching faces for individuals whom I have a suspicion regarding, okay? So in other words, these are targeted searches on particular individuals. In real-time face recognition or continuous face recognition, I am searching every single person who comes in front of my video camera. I'm either doing it in real time, or I'm running the search on archival video. And why should you care about this? Two reasons. First, it turns a basic principle of the Fourth Amendment on its head. We could have a wide, long-ranging debate that could take the full hour and a half about whether the Fourth Amendment applies. But whether or not you think the Fourth Amendment applies, there is, notwithstanding, a Fourth Amendment principle that searches, that police should not investigate individuals when they have absolutely no suspicion that they are involved in wrongdoing. Police are not entitled to engage in fishing expeditions, if you will. And in real-time face recognition, or continuous face recognition, every single person is searched, regardless of suspicion. Number one. Number two, why else should you care? This fundamentally changes the nature of public. Pardon me. Let me put that on airplane mode. This fundamentally changes the nature of public spaces. You are used to, when you're in a public space, being identified by people you have a relationship with, people who know you. Maybe you might be identified by the police, but typically police don't walk up to you and say, you know, hi Adrian, how are you doing? Please tell me where you're going today, right? There is not an expectation that law enforcement will know who you are when you walk into public spaces without having any interaction with you. And this could be a world we are headed to, depending on the databases that are plugged into these back-end systems. We're not quite there. We're not there at that world where there's a universal personal identification system via real time. But we could be there in a number of years. So these are the kinds of searches. Yes?
In the real time, are the searches also being saved? So like in that particular example, are the faces of those people also being stored and saved in that same database, or is it just searching through them?
So one thing I'm going to talk about is we were able to lift the veil on a few aspects of these real-time systems, but they are for the most part shrouded in secrecy. And so we did not get a good look at the guts of a real-time system, and so I don't know if I can answer that question. I'm pretty sure we can't answer that question right now, but I could see it going either way. So, yes?
This is probably for later, but are there laws or rights relative to collecting these databases and whether people can have access to their own information? Can I walk into a police station and ask, what do you know about me?
Right. So it depends on the system you're inquiring into. At the federal level, that's the Privacy Act, and the answer really at the federal level is no. You cannot, you have no way to figure out if you are in the FBI's face recognition database as a result of the law enforcement exceptions to the Privacy Act. At the state level, there are, for the most part, 50 different answers to that question. But our impression is that, for the most part, the answer to that question is probably no, but I don't want to give you a definitive answer because there are 50 different.
My question was more sort of constitutional. Is there any part of history, you know what I'm saying, that would apply to this?
So then your question was constitutional, but I actually maybe filling in the blank and not knowing what the blank is.
I'm just saying, not necessarily in terms of faces.
Yeah.
Are there constitutional rights to transparency in law enforcement operations?
Right. I am not, there is an aspect of the First Amendment which has to do with transparency, with access to information in the government. We have not gone down that path in much depth. We've gone down the Fourth Amendment path at significant length, but not that aspect of the First Amendment path. So let's go to the second. So we've been talking about one differentiator of risk is the kinds of search. The next differentiator is the kinds of databases you're searching against, okay? Probably the most common kind of back-end database that you're searching against are mugshot databases, okay? These are individuals who've made contact with the criminal justice system. And so this is a slightly more targeted database. Many times you are still dealing with millions of people, but it's not millions of entirely law-abiding people, it's millions of people who've made contact with the criminal justice system. Does it have its flaws? Yes. Many, many people are arrested who are never charged with a crime. And if they're charged with a crime, many of those people are found innocent or eventually have charges dropped. We met a woman in Florida named Chris Wilson, who was a classics major at the University of South Florida, studied Greek and Latin, was working on her second bachelor's, never made contact once with the criminal justice system, was arrested for peaceful civil disobedience, for trespass, and as a result of that arrest, is in not one, but two face recognition databases, probably for the rest of her life. So these are not entirely targeted, but they are more targeted than driver's license databases. We knew that the FBI was tapping into 16 driver's license databases and searching faces of law-abiding people. Thanks to our FOIA research, we found out that it wasn't just 16 states. It was at least 28 states. And when you account for that, that is a majority of American adults in this nation that are in a law enforcement face recognition network. I'm going to jump ahead for a second and focus on this slide. That has never happened before. Never in our history have we had a national law enforcement biometric network that has been populated primarily by law-abiding people. Okay, what do I mean by that? Let's talk about fingerprints, okay? The FBI's fingerprint database. In general, how do you end up, let's actually start with DNA. How do you end up in the FBI's national component of the DNA database? You are either there if you've been made contact with the criminal justice system, if you're suspected of a crime, if you're the victim of a crime, or if you're the family member of a victim of a crime, okay? In other words, this network is entirely made up of criminal or forensic DNA samples, okay? Then let's talk about fingerprints, which is the oldest biometric in law enforcement. We've been using fingerprints since the early 1900s. Who is in the FBI fingerprint database? Primarily people who have been arrested for crimes. There are other groups of folks. So I'm an immigrant. Had I entered the country post-2004, my fingerprints would be in the system. Certain people with certain kinds of sensitive jobs are also in the system. But still, the FBI fingerprint database is, in its majority, made up of folks who have made contact with the criminal justice system. Now look at the FBI's face recognition network, the face services network where they tap into 16 different states' driver's license photos and a number of other databases. This database is primarily made up of law-abiding people. This has not happened with DNA, this has not happened with fingerprints. This is the first time that we have a biometric network of essentially innocent people. So this is a very sensitive database to search against. What's the other kind of database that you see? You see a watch list. Real-time face recognition is computationally very expensive and can be very inaccurate. It is the most, one of the most difficult ways to use face recognition. Why? You are trying to identify people in frequently in uncontrolled settings, okay? It might be one thing if you're trying to get someone at an airport coming through a well-lit space and the camera is taking a head-on photo of them. In other circumstances, though, you might be trying to identify people from a camera that is looking down on them, that has a photo of partly the top of their head, and you have to do modeling in order to normalize the face and to compare it to your library of known faces. The lighting conditions are uncontrolled, they may be poor. And all of this is being done, particularly in real time, very quickly. And so typically real time face recognition systems are not run against databases of millions of people. They're run against much smaller databases. Now, importantly, as the technology improves, the back-end databases against which these systems are run will be able to increase in size. We are not quite there yet, though, where we have real-time systems that are running with any significant degree of accuracy against millions and millions of faces. But we do have folks that are trying. So with these two factors, what we've done is basically generate a risk framework for face recognition, so that police departments and policymakers and advocates can say, this is what we're really worried about. We're also worried about this. We're a little less worried, though. We identify as moderate risk deployments of face recognition uses where there is a stop and identification search or an investigate and identification search, and it's run against a mugshot database. We don't think police in these circumstances should have to go to a court and get permission to run a search when they're doing it in the field against somebody, or when they're doing an after-the-fact investigate and identify search. We think they should, however, have reasonable suspicion that the individual is engaged in criminal conduct. For investigate and identify search, which again is the surveillance camera footage for an ATM or the police officer taking a photo of people at a protest and then searching it, when the police officer isn't in contact with the people he's searching, when the search is secret, in other words, we think there should be a degree of proportionality. What the heck do I mean by that? Jonathan, let's say Jonathan is a police officer, and I am he cannot wiretap me if I'm a habitual jaywalker, okay, or if I'm repeatedly late on my taxes, okay? He can wiretap me if I'm a drug trafficker, or I'm a human trafficker, or I am, you know, a violent, or I'm a member of organized crime. That's because the Wiretap Act lets you run wiretaps on certain individuals rather than others. And so for investigate and identify searches, we propose limiting them to investigations of felony crimes, crimes for which you could go to jail for prison for more than 1 year. What is the next tier we identify? We say the next tier is in-person searches or after-the-fact searches against licensed photos. For these searches, we think you should have to go to a judge and establish probable cause that the photo of the individual you're trying to identify, that the individual pictured in the photo you're trying to scan is engaged in a serious offense. And we say, what offenses? The same offenses you could run a wiretap for, okay? This is a long established list, codified in US law, 18 USC 2516 or 17. Society has recognized those as serious crimes. Those are the crimes we're gonna allow reaching into the driver's license databases, searching the faces of innocent people to identify. Finally, what do we identify as the most concerning uses of face recognition as very high-risk uses? That is real-time or continuous face recognition. And what am I talking about? Again, I'm talking about a surveillance camera scanning the face of everyone coming by. I am talking about, and today we have not in fact seen this, although I want to be very clear about that, although there are various indications that this is where we may be headed, a body camera, a police body camera that scans the face of every person walking past the police officer. So we identify these as very high-risk uses, which you should have to go to a judge to get approval for. There should be time, place, and manner restrictions. They should be time-limited. And they should be for life and limb emergencies where other means of investigating this offense would not work. Okay? So, again, we are not banning this. Okay? If you think of the New York, New Jersey bomber, if you think about the attacks here in Boston after the Boston Marathon, those are true, bona fide emergencies where you have someone's face, you're trying to identify them. Our system would allow that by going to the judge, and our system would allow that by getting an emergency, by actually running the search first, saying we don't have time to go to the judge, and then after the fact, getting a judicial order. This is the same system we have for wiretaps. Okay? So this is our risk framework. Let's talk about what we found in our research. So the first finding, as I mentioned, is that police face recognition is more pervasive and more advanced than people realize. We've actually covered this ground a little bit up until now, but we knew it was 16 states, driver's license was searched. Now we know it's at least actually 28 states, and there may be another two states that newspapers have identified, but that we were not able to independently verify. No matter what, though, we're talking about more than one out of two adults. Here's the other thing we found. We didn't find that it was just that it was more pervasive than people realized. We found that it was more advanced than people realized. And what do I mean by that? At first, when you talk about real-time face recognition, a lot of people say, you know what, it's still too inaccurate to be reliable. You know what, this part is really science fiction. Really, people aren't doing it, okay? And what we found is that they are half right. And what I mean by that is, real-time face recognition seems to be still pretty inaccurate, but people are trying actively to do it. And so what did we find? We found technically five, but later on, a sixth jurisdiction came up. That six major jurisdictions have either stated in writing a plan to acquire or deploy real-time face recognition, or are saying that they are doing real-time face recognition. And so let me give you some examples of this. The Chicago Police Department puts out an RFP stating plans to deploy multiple services which will be necessary to allow real-time analysis. They're also purchasing a great deal of processing power that Jonathan looked through and basically would allow real-time analysis. We had South Sound 911 out of Seattle that actually acquired the ability to do real-time face recognition searches, actually acquired the hardware and software to do it, subsequently decided not to do it, but nonetheless has that capability today, and they could change their minds and start using it. We also reviewed a bunch of invoices that revealed that a lot of these police departments had actually purchased the hardware to do it, even if they didn't say they were doing it. And in places like Dallas and New York, we found police departments saying, we will do this. And finally, in LA, we found a police department, the LAPD, saying, we are doing real-time face recognition right now. We're scanning the faces of everyone walking past 16 cameras in the West San Fernando Valley. So it would be one thing if the police department said, we're going to do this, we're doing this, but then we looked at the private sector and they were more limited in their claims about what they could do, right? So it would be one thing if there was demand, but there was no supply. So what did we do? What did Jonathan do? We looked at a bunch of company websites and company prospectuses. And every major face recognition company claims to sell the ability to perform real-time face recognition system. And often, and perhaps this is in legal terms what we would call puffery, but they generally claim to have a very significant and very powerful ability to conduct face recognition. This is from the consistently top-performing NEC company, consistently performs at the top on NIST accuracy tests. They say face recognition can do far more than is generally understood. And this is a description of how we can do this in real time. So their real-time face recognition is pervasive, and real-time face recognition is more advanced than people think it is. Even this kind of science fiction, real-time scanning of every face, there is every indication that either we are there today or we are headed there in the very near term. So more pervasive, more common. Who will this impact?
Alvaro, sorry, quick question.
Yep.
In terms of companies and vendors, I know it sounds like you're saying real time is video content rather than photo content, but did you guys consider it within scope to also talk to Facebook and the social media companies that are doing the photo tagging?
No. So this is a great question. This is emphatically limited to law enforcement face recognition. And I'd be happy, Jen, to come back and talk commercial. That's another hour and a half, because one point that's super interesting in the commercial space is there is a great deal of market concentration in the law enforcement vendor space. There are a very small number of companies, I'm talking a handful or less than a handful, that dominate the government face recognition and biometric space. And they don't just do law enforcement face recognition, they also do TSA, and they do national IDs. In the commercial space, it is a lot more balkanized. Every company kind of has their own proprietary system. And so there's different risks that come about with that. There's actually even creepier is an unfair for law enforcement. There are some super creepy things that are being done in the commercial space, particularly in Russia, with a company called Entech Lab. You should read Jonathan's article in The Atlantic on how NTech Lab is empowering individuals with the ability to walk around Russia and basically just identify individuals like on the subway sitting across from them. By name, pull up their social media profile, pull up their dating profile. So there's a lot in that commercial space. We don't touch them in this report.
They're also technically different.
Yes.
I have a question about thinking about the police departments versus the state level. So in your previous slide, you gave some examples about particular police departments. And I'm wondering, for example, if Dallas is saying that it's reaching into particular databases, does that mean that Houston or Austin or other smaller cities have access to the same databases? So I guess it's a question about heterogeneity within states.
Yeah, so let me not answer with respect to Dallas, but let me give you a general answer because I don't know the Dallas answer off the top of my head. The answer is yes, in general. In general, you see a lot of sharing of these systems between police departments. And frankly, you'd probably want that, right? I mean, if I was in law enforcement and I knew, my friends down in Pinellas County had an amazing system, we're both in the business of catching bad guys, they're going to open their doors to us and let us search. And that's generally the approach that's been taken. Pinellas County is actually kind of a paragon of this. They are the oldest face recognition system in the country, law enforcement face recognition system in the country, started in 2001, and they are the de facto face recognition headquarters in all of Florida. But they also open their system to any law enforcement agency in Florida, federal, state, or local. And so if you're an FBI agent in Florida, you can run a search of a face recognition system. So there is a lot of sharing, and that's how we get the figure of at least one out of four police departments in the country have the ability to run a face recognition search. So face recognition will not affect everyone equally. It will have a disparate impact on African Americans, also young women, and potentially young people, although the research there is weaker, or the confidence intervals. And Jonathan did a wonderful thing where he made sure I did not overclaim. And so with the young people, the research I don't know if is quite there. So those are African Americans. We can look at this from a number of perspectives. The first is, whose faces are being searched in these systems? Next is, who is in the databases? And next is, how the system performs on the different demographic profiles of folks in the database. So first of all, who is face recognition used to identify? A good indicator of this are arrest to population ratios. So you look at the ratio of arrests of a demographic slice of the population. Here it's African Americans. To their percentage of the population. And you're looking at 4-1, 3-1, 2-1, a disproportionate rate of contact with law enforcement. And so this, we can be fairly confident this technology will be used to identify a disproportionate number of African Americans. And yet those same statistics in jurisdictions that use mugshot databases are going to tell you who is in the databases, right? So as a result of that disproportionate law enforcement contact, not only can we have a strong suspicion that this will be used to identify a disproportionate number of African Americans, it will also there will be a disproportionate number of African Americans in the database. So we know this is going to have a disparate impact on African Americans. Depending on the jurisdiction, it will also have a disproportionate impact from the standpoint of whose face is searched and who's in the database on immigrants, for example, and other groups. Our personal favorite, or our one of our team's favorite examples, is in Maricopa County, where former Sheriff Joe Arpaio decided to upload every single Honduran driver's license into his face recognition system. This was done to try to combat an El Salvadorian gang in MS-13. And in fairness to them, there are many Honduran members of MS-13, but we thought this was quite interesting. So the next question is, we ask first whose faces are being searched, who is in the database, and then does the system perform equally across all demographic categories? The answer to that question is a likely no. But to answer that question, we need to first talk about accuracy, okay? Accuracy is very difficult to talk about because it's really difficult to talk about accuracy as accuracy, as a single number accuracy, because we have different kinds of errors. We have false positives, we have false negatives, and other kinds of errors. And so please understand the summary I'm about to provide is, to some extent, a dumbing down of the actual field of accuracy. And Jonathan will clarify what I get wrong and what I miss. So what do I mean by the system is not that accurate? Face recognition is not DNA identification. Face recognition is not fingerprint identification in terms of accuracy. Face recognition is, why? This is a younger system. We haven't been using it for 100 years. And so it is generally found to be less accurate than those biometrics when used by law enforcement. How much less accurate? Let me give you an example from a test from a couple years ago that the FBI ran on a sample set of 1 million faces. Okay? They found that 1 out of 7 searches of that system for a particular photo returned 2 to 50 faces that were entirely innocent. In other words, 1 out of 7 times I'm searching for a person's face who is in the database, and I totally miss that person in my results. Okay? So, yes, sir?
If the search yielded 2 to 50 false positives, did it return a correct positive as well? You said if the person is in the database.
Right. So 6 out of 7 times, the correct person would be in the 2 to 50 list. 1 out of 7 times.
It's only, they're all false positives.
So right. Let's
see. Or not,
yeah.
That was the question.
Well, right, so 1 out of 7 times, they're all what we would call false positives. Law enforcement has a different perspective on this, and I want to be fair to them.
Sure.
Their perspective is, this is not, it's very interesting, because one moment law enforcement will talk about, this is helping us identify people. This is helping us find people. And the next moment, suddenly when you talk about accuracy, instead what they'll say, this is an identification. This is merely an investigative lead. And so if we find 2 to 50 faces, those aren't, they're not false positives, they're not accused of anything. Those are all just leads, right? So they prefer not to talk about it in terms of false positives. So 1 out of 7 times, though, the correct face was not returned in the answer set. I want to point out something really important. The sample set here was 1 million faces. What happens to error rates when your database goes up in general, okay? Error rates go up. One reason, you have more doppelgangers. You have more people who resemble each other. And there's probably other reasons, but that's a very prominent one. Here's the other thing. Errors are not evenly distributed in the population. There is far too little research on bias in Facebook. Yes?
So I also wanted to know if it was the same picture that was in the database or like another picture of the same person. Because if it's the same picture,
yeah,
it's an even bigger problem.
Yeah, so I don't know the answer to that question.
It's another picture.
Yeah, I think it's another picture.
If you're searching for an identical picture, you just do a pixel by pixel check and see that they're identical.
Yeah. They haven't released this study. This is a report on the study that FBI has put out. So we don't have the ability to poke it, but yeah, you can be sure that if the actual photo's in there, it'll just come up immediately. So caveats. In terms of errors across demographic groups, there is too little research in the space. There should be more research in the space, but the most one of the most prominent studies in the space has suggested, and other studies have fallen along these general same lines, that this technology is, again with a caveat with respect to the term accuracy, 5 to 10% less accurate on African Americans, women, and individuals aged 18 to 30. The confidence about the 18 to 30 was actually lower than the other findings, but let's talk about the 5 to 10% less accurate for African Americans and women. This actually means that the system has a harder time finding the faces of African Americans and women. Okay? So in other words, let's say, Bochi, I was looking for your face. You are a woman. And we were searching a man's face. Let me see if I get this right, Donna. This is a very particular thing. What this study found is that you were in the system, okay? And this other generic man was in the system, okay? The system was slightly more likely to either miss you or put you lower down in the rankings. And so some folks might say, I don't have a problem with that. You know, I don't have a problem with the system not being able to find certain folks' faces, particularly those of disadvantaged minorities. I don't have a problem with that. But here's the thing. Some systems are designed to screen out answers where there's They're designed to tell you no for an answer. Okay? They're designed to say, you're looking for this person's face. We weren't able to find anyone with any degree of confidence. And so the answer to your question is empty set, right? Other systems, however, are not designed to give you no for an answer. They're designed to, no matter what, give you a list of candidate faces. The FBI system is like this. And so in this system, Duo Chi's face might be lower in the rankings, and other faces that the system thinks look like Duo Chi will be higher. Okay, so in other words, even false negatives have consequences in these systems. Jonathan?
Can I add a tiny bit more
color?
What he said is completely accurate, and props to you for getting through all those details. So the one other thing I'll add is the study only measured the false negative rate. You can see on the charts here, they measured false accept rate against true accept rate. And so they didn't actually give us the numbers that we would have needed to say this will actually misidentify more African Americans, as opposed to this will fail to identify more African Americans. The study just didn't give us the numbers. We can infer that it's also likely the case that there were more false positives on African Americans, but the study didn't actually produce that data, and the study is now 5 years old. We contacted the authors, but I mean, anyone here who's written a paper knows how that goes.
Which means, for example, they were put me in the ranking and give me a score for my face. It looks like I'm
Korean. It could mean that when they search for someone else's face, your face might be more likely to accidentally come up. Or when they're searching for your face might be more likely to accidentally not come up. It's generally going to make more mistakes, which direction is often hard to say. They only measured one direction, but you can infer that it's likely also in the other direction.
So I'm running a little long here, and so I'm going to pick up the pace a little bit for the end of this presentation, just to make sure we have at least 20 or 30 minutes of conversation. So another important thing is, it'd be one thing if law enforcement knew that there were these problems. It'd be one thing if they knew that that these systems aren't as accurate as that they perform differently on certain groups, and so. Our general indication is that the answer is no. They do not know that, and in fact, assure the public the opposite. So this is a quote from Seattle South Sound 911 from an FAQ, and it says, is the booking photo system biased against minorities? And they say no, because machine vision only looks for similar constellation, Perrin's mathematical algorithm, it does not see race, sex, orientation, or age. The software is matching distance and patterns only, not skin color, age, or sex of an individual. I want to be fair to South Sound 911. They actually were one of the best systems in terms of the protections they afforded folks. But clearly, and by the way, this was, and it wasn't just South Sound 911 that talked about this. Pinellas County, for example, also gave press similar statements like this. And so law enforcement agencies don't seem to be aware of this. Other issues, a lot of these systems aren't built for the diversity of faces that they are going to search. One of the preliminary steps in many face recognition workflows is what's called normalization and face modeling. So let's say there's a photo of me looking down in a way. Certain face recognition systems will create a model of my face and then sort of rotate it so that it can then be compared to my library of faces that are head-on, right? How is that done? That is done by, you could do a generic male, a generic female. But let's, clearly, individuals of different ethnic groups, their faces follow similar patterns, more so than people across different ethnic groups, right? And so what some of this normalization software does is create models that are tailored for different ethnic groups. But we looked at Pennsylvania's manual for this process, and they only had models for the following kinds of faces. Men, women, sort of generically, and then Asian men, Asian women, Caucasian men, Caucasian women, and then kind of out of nowhere, Middle Eastern men. And keep in mind that African Americans and Latinos are 1/5 of the population in Pennsylvania. And as we've just been discussing, they are a population that is disproportionately likely to be searched in the system. So other data points here, NIST hasn't tested for bias regularly. And in fact, the most recent test was in 2010. They recently announced a series of great reforms to their system, many of which followed our recommendations. And when I say our, I mean the wonderful recommendations that Jonathan developed. and we emphatically agreed with. The other thing we found is Jonathan spoke to two major face recognition companies. We granted them anonymity so they could speak to us freely. And two of those companies essentially said, we don't really test for bias. Okay, despite this 2012 finding, despite this research record, we're not internally testing for bias. Do you want to add to that?
I wanted to throw in, in defense of the racial categories that are up there, a lot of these systems originated in the defense sector, and you can kind of understand where those categories might come from if this had been used in war in Iraq or in Afghanistan before making a claim with civilian settings.
So finally, these systems are not under control. Let me give you a quick snapshot of this, and let me also give you the caveat of these 52 numbers. So first of all, there is no, we have wiretapping laws, federal and state. We have geolocation privacy laws at the state level. We have drone laws at the state level. We have automated license plate readers at the state level. We do not have a single face recognition law at the federal level. And we do not really have a face recognition law at the state level. We have a couple states that say, don't use this on drone footage, or you know, don't use this on body camera footage. And we actually found one state, Colorado, recently, that it turns out has a reasonable suspicion requirement. But we don't have a single state that, in the same way they have a wiretap law, or a drone law, or ELPR law, has a face recognition law. So we're largely dealing with a rules, a statute-free zone. There is no case law directly speaking to what the Fourth Amendment or First Amendment requires with respect to face recognition. There are previous cases that deal in the First Amendment context with photographing people. There are Fourth Amendment cases, obviously, that deal with tracking people in public. But no one has really done the analysis of what the Fourth Amendment, post-Jones, for example, provides for face recognition. And this is something we can explore in the Q&A. But I frankly think Jones doesn't do anything necessarily for a great deal of face recognition tracking. And in the Jones case, that involved GPS tracking of a vehicle and its public movements on streets. And I think even the shadow majority of that case, and I can talk about what that means, don't really provide any meaningful protection. What do we have? We have police policies that are issued pretty much unilaterally by police departments. This also means that the police department can change these policies at any time. And these policies left a lot to be desired. Now, I want to be clear, there are police departments that, in our view, are doing a lot. And there are some police departments, for example, San Diego, Seattle, that are Michigan in many respects, that are going out of their way to try to have some protections in place. We still think they come up short in a lot of categories, but similarly, there's other police departments that are kind of doing whatever they want, but they're a little more transparent about it. So Pinellas County, there's actually a lot of transparency problems there, as we'll discuss, but you know what? They opened our doors to us, they answered all our questions. So this is not to impugn the police departments. This is to say, however, that they have a lot of work to do here. And what did we find of the 52 agencies that provided responsive documents? One of them limited this face recognition analysis to certain crimes, identity theft. This was, I believe, in Nebraska or Kansas. One of them said, you can't use this in their policy. Sometimes they have separate policies that say, in general, you can't monitor people for religious reasons. But in their face recognition policies, which is what, in our view, they need, they don't have things saying you shouldn't use this at a protest. Ohio is the only one that has that. Nine of them had claimed to have audit systems. Only one of them provided proof that they actually had operational audit systems. One of them, San Diego, actually requires legislative approval for its policy. And four out of the 52 had a public use policy that they posted online for the public to see. Okay, so what does that look like on the ground? That looks like police departments that sent back, this is Montgomery County, Maryland, wrote back, you know what, and to their credit, they were honest about it. They said, our police department doesn't have any manual or policies or memorandum of understandings about face recognition. This is a five-year-old system in Maryland that contains the face of every single driver in Maryland that was searched during the Freddie Gray protests to identify protesters by name and to arrest them. Never been audited. Montgomery County plugs into that system, doesn't have any rules for that system. Pinellas County system. They do have a policy. What does it say? You are encouraged to use biometric identification whenever practical. There is no reasonable suspicion requirement. Some police departments do have that requirement. About a fifth have some kind of reasonable suspicion. A couple have a probable cause requirement. Again, that's on the policy, that's not in the law. Pinellas County didn't have that. And what does that mean? It means that if I were a Pinellas County police officer, or if you, Gochi, were a Pinellas County police officer, you could use it on anyone in this room, so long as you could say, you could point to some law enforcement purpose that you are using, right? Even if you didn't suspect anyone of a crime, okay? We went down to Florida, and we talked to Sheriff Bob Gutierrez, who, to his great credit, sat down with us and was very, very candid. And we asked him, hey, do you audit the system? He said, no. The system's been running for 15 years. It's never been audited for misuse. Then we went down the street, and we talked to the public defender. And the public defender said that never in 15 years, the only way he finds out about face recognition is when a client has been stopped in the street and identified using sort of in-person identification, or their mugshot has been searched against the system. He has never been notified in discovery or in Brady evidence, which is the kind of exculpatory evidence you present at the start of trial, that this has been used to identify someone from surveillance camera footage for forensic purposes, okay? This is a system that's been used for 15 years in Pinellas County. Forensic use, investigating and identifying uses are one of the primary uses. And it would be very valuable for a public defender to know, hey, we ran a face recognition search of this bank robber, and you know what? Your client was third on that list. Here are the other two people who are at the top of that list. That never happened in 15 years in Pinellas County. Finally, is this being used in protest? The answer is yes, it is being used in protests. In Maryland, I forget whether it was Baltimore or Maryland police, searched social media photographs posted by protesters through face recognition to identify people they called rioters. And yes, some people were rioting, not all of them were rioting, with outstanding warrants. So there are just scanning faces of people whose faces were up online for people with warrants, and then they were going and plucking them out of the crowd. So I'm actually not going to go into recommendations because I've actually addressed a lot of them during the course of our conversation. The only thing I want to add is that I'm really, really proud to say that the report is having consequences. So I anticipate the biggest one is just public as of yesterday or the day before. Jason Chaffetz, chairman of the House Oversight Committee, has announced that his committee will be investigating law enforcement use of face recognition systems. So have a little over 20 minutes for questions. I'd love to leave it there and answer as many questions as possible. And if you have any questions that you want to answer separately, email me at amb420@georgetown.edu. You can also use my first name, period, then my last name at georgetown.edu. The last thing I'll say is that this project is big enough that it's quite obviously not the work product of one person. This is a whole team, and it was inspired and drew on a lot of the ideas that folks like Madars and his teammates produced. In fact, the title of the report, Perpetual Lineup, was coined by one of Madars' teammates, Alex Moser. And so this is very much a team effort. And I'll leave it at that.
So, quick question.
Yeah.
So you said that, you know, like there are regulations for drones, et cetera, but, you know, facial recognition is just one of them that doesn't have any federal or national law.
Yeah.
Do you know why that is? Like, have you guys poked around? I'm sure it's come up, but.
So I don't know if it's come up. In fact, I know it hasn't really come up in a lot of these places. The thing to know is that, for example, in Ohio enrolled every single driver in its system and kept it a secret for months. Maryland did this, and they kept it a secret essentially for years and just posted this thing on some remote website saying, by the way, we've enrolled all driver's license photos in our face recognition system. So this has not been public. The FBI's deployment of the system has been public, and there have been a couple bills offered. For the commercial side, none of them have passed, and there's been no bills, to my knowledge, for law enforcement face recognition yet. But I think the reason for that is it's not been transparent. The police generally have not said, hey, by the way, public, we are using face recognition now. It's been something that we have had to make public via FOIA. Yes?
Can you talk a little bit about your policy tool and where it's going and what will likely happen?
Our policy recommendations?
Your model state law.
Model state law, yeah. So, um, our hope is that state legislators pick this law up and introduce it. And so I'm actually not connected to the Wi-Fi, but if you go to perpetuallineup.org and then click on the drop-down menu, click on model legislation, you'll see it. Our hope is that state legislators will introduce this and pass it. The bill that you have in there is a model bill, so it is more aggressive than many, more aggressive on privacy than I think a lot of jurisdictions would prefer. So there is fat that can be cut from it. That is my hope of what will happen. Time will tell over the next couple of months if that actually happens.
What's the nature of your recommendation?
So I talked about it a little bit, but in broad strokes, we recommend that for the less sensitive uses, the police have reasonable suspicion and they limit it to serious offenses, or limit after the fact uses to serious offenses. For driver's licenses, you got to go to a judge and get approval. For real-time face scanning, continuously scanning every face, you got to go to a judge and get approval. You also have to do reporting. You have to notify people. So if you're wiretapped in general, you're told about it eventually, so that you can challenge it in court. That's been the rule since at least 1968, I believe. And there's also reports that are issued annually that say, we wiretapped folks for drug trafficking. We wiretap folks for homicide. And it's actually jurisdiction by jurisdiction reports. And this is not, this is Congress mandating this. And so we recommend that kind of system. We also think that funding should be conditioned on certain basic protections, like posting your policy publicly and getting legislative approval for it. And then finally, we have a series of recommendations for the kind of test they should run. To be very fair to NIST, I think if they had money, they'd be doing a lot of this. But it's not like they have unlimited funds for their face recognition tests. Oh, you want to go to Jim?
Okay, sure. I'm curious to get your thoughts, as you go further down this and towards policy and regulation talking to legislators on, then the other side, right, they're obviously going to hear from law enforcement and why, like, law enforcement don't think they should be taking this tool away from them.
Yeah.
But then, generally on policy, if there's a public outcry, public opinion on certain issues that supports a policy change, then even if the law enforcement is saying, don't do this, like, there's a public support for the change. And so on this issue, I'm curious on sort of what the feedback you've gotten from people. Because I think in some ways, like you're saying about with CSI, if you watch CSI for the last 10 years, or right, Law and Order, right? It's pretty much like, I think, endemic in our public culture to be like, oh yeah, we're gonna just run this picture against even if they're not federal law enforcement on the show, there's like, they somehow have access to this like federal database or like these other databases of facial recognition. And so, in your opinion, as you sort of talk to these people and you go into the policy realm, do you feel like public opinion is so used to this concept that facial recognition is so endemic that there isn't necessarily the same level of outrage or antipathy towards it?
So let me say two things. The first is as a former Hill staffer, this can sometimes sound trite, but this is not a Democrat or Republican issue.
Right.
Jason Chaffetz is a very conservative Republican, but he is a firm believer, in the Bill of Rights, and he's also a libertarian. And I think we have had, I anticipate a lot of interest from some very conservative folks,
mm-hmm.
and Jason Chaffetz, Chairman Chaffetz's interest in this reflects that this crosses party lines. To get to your other point, which I think is quite valuable, people have only seen the science fiction level benefits of this technology. There are technologies that will help you identify someone, but there is no magic enhance button. And like, if you have a partial face photo of someone's face from a camera that's looking down on them, and you have half their face, and it's grainy and it's night, you're not going to turn that into a photo that is going to very easily find your guy. And yet people get this impression that it can happen. And so they have this outsized impression of what it can do, but they have no impression of the mistakes that are made. And there are mistakes made,
right.
Okay? In New York has said, New York has actually stonewalled us with our FOIA, but randomly they'll decide to just say something to press at one point or like put something on a website. And they've acknowledged at least 5 cases where there have been cases of mistaken identity as a result of fake. They've arrested 3,000 people for this, right? But they've voluntarily admitted 5 mistakes, and you know, when you voluntarily admit mistakes, sometimes you don't admit all the mistakes. So once I think people start learning about these mistakes, once people start learning about cases like what happened in Baltimore, I think you're going to have more of an outcry. So I am optimistic about the ability to have common sense regulation here, and I want to push back. I know this was not the force of what you were saying, but this is not taking this away from anybody, right? I frankly think there's going to be a lot of folks who think sincere privacy advocates who want to ban this. We are not those folks. We want there to be common sense rules, though, and that we don't have any. Larry.
Thanks. My question's not unrelated to that. I want to ask a question about your risk framework slide, and just what exactly is the risk is of, if it's of inaccuracies or biases, or if it's the risk of the different uses of the technology as such.
Yeah.
So I imagine if you said this to someone, that the risk is the inaccuracies or the biases, someone who's really in favor of all this will say, well, the technology's in its infancy. Once the technology is perfected, then we won't have these other things. And yet, these different situations might still propose, on your view, I'm not sure, different types of risks.
Excellent question. And to answer your question, there are varieties of risk. And what we've tried to do with this is make it such that it addresses those different varieties. So as you go down, you get lower accuracy. And so as you go up this framework, so let's say this was at the highest risk, right? This is the highest risk. These deployments are significantly less accurate than these deployments. And number two, in our view, the risk to civil liberties is significantly greater. So here you are stopping someone on the street, you are transparently taking a photo of them, they're aware of this interaction, they're aware that their face is now in the system, some system, maybe they don't know how it's used. Here, and it's one person, right, or a couple of people. Here, you are scanning the faces of large groups of people in secret. You're doing this, you're essentially conducting suspicionless searches of their faces in large groups. In our view, you're redefining the nature of public spaces. So there's a couple different risks that are tiered here. And by the way, why is it less accurate? Well, you're doing this in real time, or you're continuously scanning every face. Generally, when you're continuously scanning large groups of faces, they're not presenting themselves like this, right? They're not presenting themselves in good lighting, head on. They're generally kind of going about their daily lives in uncontrolled settings. That brings in accuracy. Secondly, here, license photo databases tend to be bigger than mugshot databases. As your databases grow in size, you get greater inaccuracy. So it's various kinds of risks that we try to tier here.
Yeah, I'd be interested to hear more about what you think about public space, because what I was wondering is how to respond to someone that says, well, imagine that the technology is perfected. Cameras get better all the time.
Yeah.
Computer processing power, you know, is going up. What if it were perfect and
mm-hmm.
identification were without error?
Mm-hmm.
Then do we still need to worry?
Yeah, so, I mean, I have not found a single face recognition expert that thinks that world will exist. You know, face recognition is not DNA, you know, it is, and DNA also, you know, there's a small degree of mistake, but I don't see a world, I mean, we've been analyzing fingerprints for 100 years, and we've been doing so in an automated manner for 15 or 20 years, and yet fingerprint systems still make mistakes. Even so, though, okay, so to take the bait a little bit, I still think, you know, should someone who should you use this for ticket enforcement? Should you use this for jaywalking, right? Should you not let those people show their faces in public, take their kids to school, go for a walk Sunday down the street because they're a jaywalker? right? Or could, because, you know, they drove too fast. Or do you want to use this in a limited manner? And finally, I urge you to consider that we're not banning this technology. We do think it should be used in real time in these spaces to find really bad folks. And so what we want to do is ensure that if we are searching every face in a public space, we're doing so for a very good reason. So I don't know if we're going to, I'm not aware of any face recognition expert that thinks we're going to get to the world of even DNA level accuracy in the near term. And even if we are, I think there are very strong arguments to not invading public space in that manner. And an important thing to I'll leave it there. Fair questions. Let me just go to our friend who just joined and then go back to you since you already asked one question, but we'll go back. Go ahead.
Could you explain a little bit more about the racial bias test that you suggested in your recommendations? I mean, I would expect the consequence to be if there is a disparate amount of African-American faces in the database that the software would learn would be more accurate.
Right,
so
right.
So the adverse consequence.
Right. So our general impression is that, so there are algorithms that continue learning, and there are algorithms that learn, are packaged and shipped off. Okay. Our general impression, and I wish Jonathan were here, but our general impression is that most of these systems are of the latter variety. Okay. So they're learning in a controlled setting, packaged or shipped off and sent off, and then the upgrade costs money. You get the better algorithm, you pay for it, and so when they're in the operational setting, they're not doing much learning. But to get to one of the underlying points you're making, we do think there should be better teaching of these algorithms. We do think that NIST should develop data sets of identified faces for African Americans, for women, for young people, so that companies have data sets of known faces to train their algorithms on. When they are in the learning phase, I think that generally. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, that's okay. An interesting model. Just to give it away without, I don't know. I see a lot of commercial enterprises, and I feel like they would rather be in control of the software and continuously train it than deploy some version to the actual law enforcement agency.
Right. Well, that's what they do. That's what they do. But remember, they're not learning on. Some of them might be learning on mugshots. Once it's in law enforcement's hands, though, it doesn't continue learning, right? So once it's used to identify all those faces on the street, it's not still learning, right? Go ahead.
You've introduced a very important kind of analysis. This risk framework, the model law, the proportionality concepts that you want to introduce. My strong impression is that the law that you're proposing or the laws that are going to happen are lagging the technology by a lot.
Sure.
And that the major contribution of the work you've started is actually in opening up the discussion, which you've avoided strenuously in your talk, to correlation of multiple methods.
Right.
So the question was already asked, and it was the first part of my is what happens when the thing is perfect?
Right.
And that question, now what I'm saying is that when you consider that iris scans can now be done at 10 meters, not necessarily quickly enough to scan an entire stadium, but that we're collecting very high resolution data. We have gate data. We have tracking of the mobile devices. And you have things like bacterial tracking, not just DNA, but you now have fingerprinting of bacterial remnants. What seems to me is happening, even before you introduce all the commercial tracking that's done, is that we're nearing perfection, or we can tell that we are going to get to perfection due to correlation, not due to the technology of machine learning getting better in the way that you present this.
Right.
Therefore, I'm asking, where do you take this wonderful innovation in, let's analyze the risk and the control around the risk, and basically say, look, within 5 years, it'll be perfect, and now we have to deal with the fact it'll be perfect because of correlation, not because
this particular branch of it is perfect. Yeah, that's a powerful point, and I wish because you're precisely right. I mean, a world where I am identifying this random person's face on the street and correcting it, scanning it, matching it against 28 million faces and trying to identify that, we're not going to get, you know, in our lifetimes where it's 100% accurate. But let's say you have the first two digits of his or her license plate, right? And you can compare that to the state database, pull up every driver that drives a car with those two first digits, and you can tell that the person is heavy set, so you throw out all the faces of folks who are skinny, and you know that from the driver's license. And suddenly you're working with a database of, you know, 50,000 faces as opposed to 7 million faces. And then you know that you're doing this in Boston as opposed to, you know, Cape Cod, right? And so then suddenly you've got 2,000 faces. And then suddenly, hey, you're able to find the person. So I think the natural answer to your question is we eventually need to move to legislation that is entirely technology neutral. I have never seen this done successfully, never. And I've been in I was in the Senate for 5 years, heading up or staffing Senator Franken's privacy subcommittee for 5 years, 4 years. I've never seen a piece of legislation that is entirely technology neutral. And that's, there's a reason for that. And it's the following. It's that. Everyone says technology outpaces law, technology outpaces law, but here's the thing. When you're pushing a bill through Congress, and your bill is vague, and your bill is ambiguous, people will come up to you and just give you a gazillion different reasons why you should make it more specific. Law enforcement says, I want clarity on precisely what this means in this circumstance. You know, companies will say, like, I could read this 16 different ways. And so what you do is you start making it specific. But as you do that, you start coding into it, the current state of technology. And so, so if you go specific, you know, stakeholders like it because it's very certain, right? But then you get to the space where suddenly, you know, the law regulates face recognition, and actually the number one remote identification means is iris, or is olfactory recognition, or gait. Who the heck knows? And suddenly the law is a dead letter. But if you're broad, I mean, try pushing a broad law through Congress that's like, when police track your location, you know, they have to get a warrant. In theory, and that's actually something I would like to explore, and in the center we have the luxury of not having to be constantly responsive. And when you said that, I was just thinking to myself, it'd be incredible to write a report on non-technology specific police geolocation. You know, I don't care how you're doing it. ALPR, face recognition, iris, I don't care. Here is a model law that just gets at the principle of finding someone. I think that'd be a wonderful exercise, and that's a great idea. Probably have time for just one more question. Yes?
I had a question about, I think you showed in one of the counties they added that extra category of Middle Eastern man.
Yeah, so Pennsylvania.
Right, so.
For the modeling.
Yeah, and. So Obama actually tried to add that to the census.
MENA,
I'm sure that you've seen that Trump has proposed a Muslim registry, and I think that this category of Middle Eastern man is almost a proxy for religion, for like being Catholic or Islam. Is there anything in current case law that can protect against these proxies that we've seen in this data age that actually reveal way more about the real civil liberties protection?
Could you say the last part of your question again? I got all the sort of background, but then what was your question?
basically Middle Eastern man is a proxy for being Muslim.
Sure.
Is there anything in case law or in precedent or in our U.S. code that can protect against these proxies that are coming up in the day age?
In can you be more specific about what context?
So if I were to add Middle Eastern man now to all facial recognition software,
yeah.
and I specifically targeted Middle Eastern men and disproportionately created that platform, is there anything that would protect people with that?
Okay, so powerful question. The answer very much depends on the specific, on the very specific circumstances in which you're dealing. So Jin, for example, Dr. Sweeney, Professor Sweeney, do a lot of analysis on sort of disparate impact of certain commercial practices in the government discrimination, in the employer discrimination setting, and in other settings. There's general, it is not okay to use a proxy, right? And so it is not okay, you know, and this comes up all the time when people either intentionally discriminate or unintentionally discriminate. They'll say like, oh, I wasn't banning all Latinos. I was just saying, you know, you, I don't know, insert, you know, race and ethnicity neutral proxy for Latinos. You know, I just said those folks can't be a part of this, right? That's not okay. Separately, there's a fifth, there's an equal protection analysis to be done, and I cannot claim to be an equal. One thing we're doing as kind of the follow-ons of this is looking through what due process, the due process obligation, the Fifth Amendment, equal protection. The Fifth and 14th Amendment. But equal protection is only the 14th, or is it the Fifth? 14th. Well, it's definitely the 14th, but yeah, it's not in the Fifth. So this is an embarrassment. Let's not get this on video. No. So we're digging as to what the equal protection obligation and due process obligation mean. I can't give you an analysis on that. But yeah, the answer to your question is yes, but it's very different specifically.
I'm so sorry.
No worries.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. All right. Thank you.